Welcome to worship at First Presbyterian Church, where we are all about, say it with me, loving God, loving neighbors, and living with purpose. It's great to have you with us here in person, and it's great to have you with us in a digital way as well. However you are worshiping with us, it is great to have you with us. Just a few announcements today. We are going to recognize three of our graduating seniors who have been such an integral part of our youth group for the last few years. So that'll come later in worship, and be ready to be proud, let's just say that. Next Sunday, Pentecost Sunday, so be sure and wear your red ties. If you have a red suit, I dare you to wear it, okay? Session will be meeting on Monday, and I am positive, 100% sure, that they will be examining the current policy around safe distancing and the use of masks. We're all aware of the CDC recommendations that changed last week, as well as the county recommendations. So just know that Session has that on their agenda to discuss tomorrow. Again, welcome to worship. Friends, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Please rise in body or spirit for the call to worship. From comfortable pews, from bicycle seats, from the recliner in front of your TV.
God gathers us in, giving us the words with which to remain in the hospital.
At kitchen sinks, in front of a laptop, at a nursing station. In communities gathered to pray, in memories of those who served, in families celebrating graduations.
The Holy Spirit fills us with God's joy.
Let us pray. Mysterious God, you reveal yourself in Jesus, your beloved child, who gives us a glimpse of your glory and invites us to share in the unity of all that is holy. The holiness that is you, your creation, and your people, united in spirit that breaks through all boundaries of fear and injustice. Meet us here today and teach us how to live as one in love for each other, one in understanding with all who long for you, one in peace with all who seek the path of truth. We ask all this in the name of Jesus, whose fervent prayer is ever, may there all be one. Amen. We delight in your law, O God, but we don't always follow the rules. Guard us with your mercy, that we may follow your will closely. Draw them ever closer to you and one another, that we might support one another as we follow where you lead us in reference to create a world of unity and boundless love. In your mercy and grace, pray. God watches over us with mercy and grace. Christ forgives, flow freely, redeeming us and making us whole.
Good morning, young disciples. Good to see you all today. Welcome. I want to say just one little thing before we begin our moment together, and that is congratulations to Adelaide Cochran and Garrett Adams, who are receiving their third grade Bibles today, immediately after worship. We're so proud of them. You know, third grade is the age where you really get the reading down. So it seems like a good time to give them their Bibles. So congratulations to them. Well, now, let's just look around here, young disciples. Does it normally look like this up here on a Sunday? No. I was just saying this morning, I bet it has never looked like this in the history of First Presbyterian Church. So we have bags and bags, almost like a mountain. It's almost like having two mountains. Does it feel like a mountain is behind you, Cynthia? Mm-hmm. And food all over the place. And we have this because we've been bringing it to, as part of our five-Sunday drive for Matthew 25, we are collecting food and clothing because we know, Jesus taught us that whenever we give food to people who are hungry or clothing to people who need clothing, it is exactly the same as doing it for Jesus. So now we have all this wonderful stuff, and we need to dedicate it. Do you know what the word dedicate means? Dedicating means we are setting it aside for a special purpose. This isn't for us to keep. This isn't just so we can make a big old mess in the sanctuary, as fun as that has been. This is for people, our brothers and sisters. And so we're going to dedicate it by blessing it. And so I want to invite disciples, young and old, wherever you are, to just lift up a hand, and we're going to bless all this stuff. All right, would you pray with me, please? Say, dear God, we thank you. Oh, okay, well, you can repeat it. Okay. Dear God, thank you so much for giving us more than we need. Thank you that we have plenty to share. Bless those who will eat this food. Bless those who will wear these clothes. Help us to see your face in everyone we meet. Thank you for our blessings. Amen. Well, very well done. Good job. Amen.
May the reading of your word sanctify us in the truth and bring us the perfect joy. Amen. Our first reading is Psalms 1. Happy are those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or take the path that sinners tread, or sit in the seat of scoffers. But their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law they meditate day and night. They are like trees planted by streams of water, which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves do not wither. In all that they do, they prosper. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish.
Our second reading this morning comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 17, verses 6 through 19. Let us listen for the Word of God. I have made your name known to those whom you gave to me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave to me, I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you. And they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine. And I have been glorified in them, and now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost, except the one destined to be lost, so that the Scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the world, so that they may have my joy made complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one, that they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, so that they may also be sanctified in truth. Friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The scripture today highlights the truth that there are actually two Lord's prayers. There's the Lord's Prayer that we commonly think of, where Jesus taught his disciples how to pray, and we recite that prayer every Sunday as part of the pastoral prayer. And then there's the prayer that we have today, where Jesus prays over his disciples, whom he will soon leave behind. This prayer is sometimes referred to as Jesus's high priestly prayer. Today's scripture took me all the way back to 1972. My confirmation class had just finished up a very long and involved process that had included study, group discussion, prayer, movies, and visits to other faith traditions. And now it was our time to decide whether we would make the decision to commit ourselves as disciples of Jesus Christ, be baptized, and be confirmed in the United Methodist Church. In our final group discussion, our confirmation leaders prayed a version of this prayer over us. Gracious God, they prayed, we've taught these disciples what we can, and now we are turning them over to you. Now, you know, it can be very heartening to have an individual or group of individuals pray over you in that way. This week I was remembering a couple of years ago, Sandra's installation, where we all, with hands laid on, prayed for her calling as the pastor at First Presbyterian Church. One could feel the earnest, heartfelt expression of love and care. This sort of prayer creates a sense of intimacy as if God is there surrounding you in that very moment. And I'll always remember 1972 being prayed over in that way. It felt as if I was being ushered into the presence of God. We'll fast forward a couple of decades, and a version of this prayer was exactly what I prayed for my boys on the night before they would fly the coop, leave the house, and embark out into the world to leave their own mark. I prayed things that most parents pray for their children. God, these little boys you gave me 18 years ago, they are heading out. I've poured myself into them. I've taught them. I've shared my faith with them. And now I trust them to you. Protect them and keep them safe from all things evil. Help them live a happy life. Keep them as your own. That is the sort of prayer that a parent prays for their children. A prayer placing someone near and dear to your heart in God's hands. Well, in just a short while today, we will pray over our graduating high school seniors. There's one over there, and there's a couple of them over here. And in that prayer, while the words may sound a little bit different, the sentiment of the love and the care and the pride will be there. And my hope is that after all the celebrations of today, as these young people walk across that stage and continue their journey of faith, the moments of this morning will, for many years down the road, hold for them a profound sense of God's love and the love of this congregation. You know, sending our kids into the world can be a little bit bittersweet. Author Irma Bombeck once wrote of the joys and the sadness of letting children fly off into the world. She wrote, "I see children as kites. You spend a lifetime trying to get them off the ground. You run with them until you're both breathless. They crash. They hit the rooftop. You patch and comfort, adjust and teach. You watch them lifted by the wind and assure them that someday they'll fly. Finally, they are airborne. They need more string and you keep letting it out. But with each twist of the ball of twine, there is a sadness that goes with joy. The kite becomes more distant, and you know it won't be long before that beautiful creature will snap the lifeline that binds you together and will soar as it was meant to soar, free and alone. Only then will you know that you did your job." And that's what's happening today during worship. We will recognize three young people who have achieved this milestone in life and who are now ready to soar. And while they will be living in one world, they will be representing a different one. They represent the world which belongs to the faith community. They will be in the world, not of the world. And we honor them on this special day. And we send them soaring into the world, trusting in God's provision and care. And So while over the past couple of years our young people have listened to more than a few discussions, some might call them lectures, about what it means to be a disciple of Jesus, today's message is really for all of us. Because this prayer which Jesus prayed that day, He prayed not just for those disciples before Him, but the disciples in here now, for all of His disciples. And this morning I hope to share a few nuggets of wisdom from that prayer. The first nugget is this: keep prayer at the center of your life. Prayer was important in the life of Jesus. It is what fed Him. It is what kept Him centered. It is what kept His spirit filled. When Jesus needed a respite, what did He do? He removed Himself from the crowd surrounding Him, found a way to be alone, and prayed. And as His followers, we do well to follow His lead. In His prayers, Jesus wasn't just speaking to some distant, far away deity. When He speaks to God, He uses the word Abba, which we might rightly translate as Papa or Daddy. And don't you just love the imagery of us as adoring children calling out to a loving God, a God who is our Papa, our Daddy? So even when you don't know what to pray, pray anyway. Because God answers prayers not according to our understanding, but according to God's mercy and wisdom. As faithful people, it's easy to get so wrapped up in doing things for God that we forget to just spend time with God. If you remember the biblical story of Mary and Martha, that's what happened with them. Martha was the busy sister doing things for Jesus, and Mary was the sister who spent time with Jesus. And Mary was the one whom Jesus commended for having chosen the better part, spending time with Jesus. So keep prayer at the center of your life, and pray often, remembering that God is crazy about you. God is in love with you, and God notices you, and nothing is ever going to change that. Another thing to glean from today's text is that Jesus offers life in abundance, eternal abundance. Through this prayer, Jesus reveals the bedrock of His ministry on earth, and that is to bring His disciples eternal life in God's kingdom. Jesus puts it this way: Father, the time has come. Glorify Your Son, that Your Son may glorify You. For You granted Him authority over all people, that He might give eternal life to all those You have given Him. Jesus gives us eternal life simply through knowing Him, being His disciples, studying His life, modeling our lives after His. That is our response to knowing Him. And knowing Jesus is knowing God. In John 17:3, Jesus says, "And this is eternal life, that they may know You, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom You have sent." Jesus came to reveal His heavenly Father and Himself to His disciples. And here's the deal: not just to first century disciples, but to all disciples. One final thought I'll share about this morning's reading, and that is that Jesus prayed for God to sanctify us. And as a follower of Jesus, we are sanctified. We are holy. Jesus prays to God, saying, sanctify them in the truth. The word sanctify comes from Hebrew, and it means to separate, to set aside. It means God has set us aside, and we are called to live a different way of life. We are called not just to live for God, but we are called to live with God. God chose us to feed the hungry by collecting 1,379 food items. Leah counted them herself with a little bit of help. So that's a good number. It's as good as you're going to get today. And more than that, God's Holy Spirit is at home in us as we do God's work. And because of that, the Holy Spirit is changing us from the inside out, equipping us to carry out God's plan for our lives. And we are never the same. Our old self is continually being transformed. As the Apostle Paul wrote, and you'll remember this from a couple of years ago, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, goodness, faithfulness, and self-control. That fruit is being cultivated in each of us by the Holy Spirit every moment of our lives with every breath that we take. So, listen up, young people. You have been set aside by God. Listen up, not so young people. You have been set aside by God. You are God's own, and nothing you can ever do or not do is ever going to change that. Nothing. In his book, Ruthless Trust, author Brennan Manning writes about God's unchanging love, saying, I have a word for you. I know your whole life story. I know every skeleton in your closet. I know every moment of sin, shame, dishonesty, and degraded love that has darkened your past. Right now, I know your shallow faith, your feeble prayer life, your inconsistent discipleship. And my word is this: I dare you to trust that I love you just as you are and not as you should be, because you're never going to be as you should be. Friends, remember that God chose us and dedicates us for special service. And that service is to love God and to bring others to do the same. And out of God's grace, we are continually made ready for that mission. All we have to do is put our trust in God. In his high priestly prayer, Jesus encourages us to make prayer the center of our days, to get to know Jesus better and to follow him, and to rest comfortably in the knowledge that we are set aside as God's very own. Thanks be to God for that. Amen.
Well, you've already given so generously and beautifully of food and clothes, And now God invites us to give the testimony of our hearts in practical offerings of money and time. So we can do that very easily and simply by placing our offering in the offering boxes as we exit today, or you can always go online and make a safe and secure donation by going to donate.fpctopeka.org. Let us now testify to God's love by bringing our gifts. Bless these gifts to be nourishment for a world hungry for your grace. Bless us to be nurturers of love for a world hungry for your compassion. Bless us to be one in ministry with you and with one another through the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you.
We come to that point in the worship where we are recognizing our graduating seniors, and I'm going to invite them to come up one at a time as I call their name, just so you get a chance to see them. So let's pick on Samantha first. Samantha Vieira, come on up. And Ellie Buchholz, come on up. And no, we're not going to leave you sitting out there, Emily. You're not off the hook that easy. So, Emily Metzger, come on down. You might recognize these folks. You might not. They have been in worship a time or two over the last couple of years when we were doing fundraisers, or you may have seen them selling sub sandwiches. I can tell you for the last several years, they were the stalwarts of the senior high group that that meets on Wednesday nights. And these three are graduating this year. They will walk across the stage today, right? And so today we are honoring them who will graduate today. These three have been cornerstones in the resurgence of our senior high youth program at First Presbyterian Church. And despite the challenges this past year, a year filled with, as we all know, separation and isolation and stress, a year where youth leaders, Linda Nance and Pat Yancey, would worry about how our youth were doing, about the well-being of them, well, these three young ladies didn't just survive, they thrived. And I'm going to share a little bit about that. So both Emily and Ellie completed their high school requirements while serving as leaders on the state champion cheer squad at Shawnee Heights High School. They both successfully completed their CNA studies, passed their exams, and have begun working in local patient care in the medical field. Both are continuing their education at Washburn University and have accepted scholarships where they will participate in cheerleading while working towards degrees in nursing. Emily, I understand, hopes to work at St. Jude's Hospital after she graduates. Well, Samantha will graduate today from Seaman High School, where she achieved a perfect 4.0 GPA. This fall, she will be continuing her education at Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. She plans to earn a double major in percussion music education and either psychology or biochemistry. And as you can see, all the worry over the past year was for naught, and we have no need to worry about these young ladies or their future. They are already busy working to transform that world around them. So we are excited to celebrate the accomplishments of these members of our faith community. So Samantha, Ellie, and Emily, we give blessings to you for all that you have achieved and many more achievements yet to come.
One part of your life's journey is complete. You will prepare to begin another journey that will take you to places unimaginable today. As you journey, you will soar ahead of many people who have and will continue to love and support and pray for you over the years. Remember them and visit once in a while.
We give you blessings of goodwill and love as you journey forth into the world. We thank you for the laughter and the fellowship and the faith that you have shared with us. And we pray that as you begin your next journey, remember these times shared between us. Use those memories as a beacon to guide you on your path. Don't look back. Continue only forward, using those memories to create a new path.
We pray that God will give you strength and determination to develop new relationships that will help strengthen and sustain your faith. Because we are made in the image of God, we have been blessed with free will to make choices and decisions. We pray that you make wise and rational decisions, always turning to God for help. God hears, God listens, God is always with you. Do not forget that. Always keep in mind that God is around, and if you turn to God, God will guide you.
Come on up, Linda. Samantha, Emily, and Ellie, as you now soar and make your way into the world, we have some gifts for you. And Linda, there's a name on each one of those if you on the card itself, so you know what goes to whom. It is our hope that these gifts will offer you encouragement during difficult times, help you grow in your faith, and let you know how much you are loved and how proud we are. Let's pray. Gracious God, surround these, our beloved graduates, with your grace. Bless them with hope so that they move into the future with eager and open hearts. Help them to put the knowledge, skills, and insights gained through their education to use for the good of all humankind. Inspire them to believe in the goodness of life even when faced with challenges and difficulties. As they move into this new chapter, may they grow ever more grateful, compassionate, and wise. All this we ask in the name of Jesus, your beloved Son. Amen. Congratulations, you guys. We pray. God of grace, together we turn to you in prayer, for it is you who unite us. You are the one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in whom we believe. You alone empower us for good. You send us out across the earth in mission and service in the name of Christ. In all of this, we sometimes fall short as disciples of Jesus, who came to save us and teach us how to love. Lord, forgive us, restore us, and teach us to love one another. God, hear the cries of all creation, the cries of the land and seas, the air and all living things, the cries of those who are exploited, marginalized, abused, and victimized, all who are dispossessed and silenced, their humanity ignored, all who suffer from any form of disease, from war, and from the crimes of the arrogant who hide from the truth, distort memory, and deny the possibility of reconciliation. God, guide all in positions of leadership towards decisions of moral integrity. We give thanks for your blessings and signs of hope that are already present in the world, especially in the young people who will graduate today and in whom we hold great promise and hope. We give thanks for those who have gone before us in faith, for open dialogues that have begun within our own church and with those in the community as we work together for justice and peace every day. We thank you for the good news of Jesus Christ and the assurance of resurrection. O God, by the power of guidance of your Holy Spirit, may our prayers never cease and never be empty words, but an urgent response to your living word, in direct action for positive change, in bold, clear, specific acts of solidarity, liberation, healing, and compassion, readily sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. Open our hearts to love and to see that all people are made in your image, to care for creation and affirm life in all its wondrous diversity. Transform us in the offering of ourselves so that we may be your partners, to strive for the full, visible unity of the one church of Jesus Christ, to become neighbors to all as we live into the new kingdom you have ushered into our midst. God, in your grace, transform the world. We pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Graduate at 1 o'clock, you have to be at the school by noon, so a couple of them are running out on us. Friends, go forth. Make prayer the center of your life. Get to know Jesus and get to know God. And remember always that you are set aside as God's own. Go and may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.